The pictures from Gaza are heartbreaking. The United Nations reports more than 2,000 Palestinians were killed during the most recent conflict between Israel and Hamas. Thousands of homes and businesses were destroyed, and some estimates say that with current restrictions in place, full reconstruction could take as long as 20 years. Well, joining us now from Jerusalem is Jan Egeland. He's the Secretary General of the Norwegian Refugee Council. Mr. Egeland, thanks for joining us. What exactly does your organization do in Gaza?
We're one of the organizations that is active on the ground in Gaza. We have a lot of staff there that also lived through the war. I come out of Gaza today. I was shocked to see the destruction. Whole apartment blocks are leveled to the ground, really. And as you rightly say, we're not able to reconstruct, even though much money was pledged in Gaza in the Cairo conference yesterday. We're not able to rebuild until there is a lifting of the blockade of Gaza.
And you know, you talk about the level of devastation in Gaza during the war. As we look at these pictures, we can see what that was like. So what are the major challenges an organization like the Norwegian Refugee Council faces in trying to reconstruct this area?
Well, first, we need money. So we hope that the donors that have pledged money will come up with their pledges and realize them with actual funding very soon. Number two, we need to be able to import, take in all of the construction material that we need. At the moment, some 30 trucks per day are allowed into Gaza with construction material. What we need as aid organizations to do the rebuilding are 440 trucks, so 12 times more. With 440 trucks per day, it would take 5 years. With the 30 trucks per day, it would take more than a generation to rebuild. So we have to end the status quo as it is. We have to get a new peace process, a security guarantee for Israel, yes, but we also need to have the border closures opened.
Why are these trucks not being allowed in? Were you given any reasons why only 30 trucks are being allowed in every day?
Well, it is simply because Israel is now occupying all of the borders except this stretch in the south, which Egypt is controlling. And Egypt is also keeping a strict border closure in the sense that every single person going in or every single truck going in are controlled by the Israelis. And the Israelis then say, we're only allowing in very few. To us, this seems like a collective punishment of an entire population for what has been done by the extremists who sent rockets into Israel. What we're proposing is some kind of a Heathrow airport security system where you can screen thousands of people very easily, thousands of tons very easily every day. It should be possible in this day and age to avoid punishing collectively very poor people who now also have their whole life, their whole home, their whole livelihood devastated.
And if you're making these kinds of suggestions where people and goods can be screened more effectively and more quickly, what kind of response are you getting from the Israelis and the Egyptians?
I think they are both saying that no, we have to live by so strict security regulations that we cannot open up like you suggest, and then we're back to an economic strangulation of Gaza. Some are calling it the largest prison on earth. Very few people are allowed to leave. Few people are allowed in. Too few trucks are allowed in. So let's turn it and say, why don't, for example, the Americans or the European Union take over border control and screen everything like they would do on any large international airport that is very safe for terrorists these days. And we are allowed to take in, and Palestinians are allowed to export what they produce. That would lead to a positive change for Gaza and not this horrible situation where we have to return to Gaza to rebuild it every 3 years.
The Norwegian Refugee Council also manages many refugee camps in the Gaza Strip. Something like 230,000 displaced people are under your care. What are conditions like inside those refugee camps right now?
Well, we're only one of the agencies working for the refugees. The number one is the United Nations UNRWA, United Nations Relief and Works Agency. Conditions are really very bad. Some of the refugee camps were taking a lot of this devastation. On top of that, 120,000 new people have become displaced, if you like, by the war. These 120,000 people are in schools, in collective centers, with neighbors. Some are crammed into existing refugee camps. Conditions are really pitiful. And what I found the most sad is to see the sense of hopelessness. Youth in Gaza have sort of given up hope that it could be better. And that is very dangerous for Israel, that deserves security. But how can you have security if everybody's lost hope in your neighbor? What you will get is more and more extremism and more hate. So it's a vicious cycle we have to change for the better of Palestinians and for the better of Israelis.
So you say people are now living in schools. So what about school programs? Are children not going to school right now? Are they not being educated at all?
Too many children are not going to schools because their school buildings are occupied by refugees and displaced. 220 schools are also lacking in the sense that there has been this enormous demographic increase in Gaza. There are more than 1.8 million people in this tiny place. I mean, Gaza is smaller than an average Norwegian municipality. And there we have 1.8 million people. Population is growing very rapidly. There is not enough school classrooms for the kids who need it, neither for the refugee kids nor for the normal youth population.
Jan Egeland, thanks for joining us, sir.